Fitzpatrick takes the snap, drops back, lobs it back right corner. Decker! He's got it! Touchdown! Eric Decker scores! And the Jets have won it in overtime!
This is the Jet Take with Ben Blessington and Kyle Fahey.
Welcome back to another episode of the Jet Take. Oh, Jets are off in midseason form. 0-1 already. Disappointing start to the Jets season. But, you know, the season is not over. The sky is not falling like many Jets fans seem to think it is. Kyle and I will discuss the Jets versus Bengals game. We have a game tomorrow night. And that's the one good thing about having this game on Thursday is we don't have to live with this loss for too long. We can just get right back to playing football, and hopefully the Jets can rebound, go 1-1. As always, we're on Twitter at the Jet Take. We are now on iHeartRadio. That is the new way you can reach us. That happened a couple days ago. They just accepted us. We're all over the place: Instagram, Facebook, pretty much anywhere. You could think so. Always just connect with us, and we love talking to our callers and stuff. Well, I think now is the time of the show where I bring on my co-host, and he's heated. And part of me thinks it's an act because his reaction to this Bengals Jets game was ridiculous. Overreaction Monday. He didn't calm down until basically yesterday. So yes, it's time to bring on Mr. Fahey, also known as Mr. Money. Kyle Fahey, you're on.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money.
Now, Kyle,
here
I'm really...
Here comes the money.
Oh, yeah. Double
up. Why are you... Kyle, you're not
that.
In charge. Okay, whatever. Kyle, how's it going, man? I don't think you're Mr. Money anymore after your reaction to this Jets-Bengals game. Obviously, we were all mad, but you were... This team showed no heart. They're not going to the playoffs. They're not going to win any games. I mean, you were overreacting quite a bit. So just speak on your reaction to the game against the Bengals.
Yeah, I will admit I definitely overreacted. I still feel the same about a couple bits in my argument, but I'm sure we'll dive into those towards the end of the show. Just a bad loss for the Jets. A game that very, very winnable. Should have won it. A lot of mistakes on offense. A lot of mistakes on special teams, and a lot of mistakes in the secondary. These are things we need to improve on. Like I said, we will alliterate on those a little later. But I think we got a special guest on the line, Ben.
Yeah, we're going to get to that in just a second, Kyle. But let's just talk a little bit more about this Jets-Bengals game for just a few more seconds. It could be a lot worse, Jets fans, although it's painful to lose a game like that. At least the Jets didn't come out and just look absolutely awful. The offense had no idea what they were doing because, I mean, they didn't the second half. But in the first half, they looked pretty good. You have to look at the positives. Matt Forte looked great. The defensive line is better than we've ever seen them, and they don't have arguably their second-best defensive lineman in the rotation, and they're starting outside linebacker. We lost this game because, just dumb, chances of fate. I mean, the blocked field goal inside the five is just ridiculous. I don't know who to pin that on because I don't want to blame it on Folk. I guess he could have, chipped it higher. A lot of times I don't like to blame blocks on the kickers because they're just kicking the ball. A lot of that blame can go on the offensive lineman, maybe Tanner Purdom because it was right over the middle. But I'm not too mad about that. The extra point kills me because it's like Nick Folk hit it right down the line. It looked like it was perfect, and then it was like almost like God didn't want us to win or something. It was just this just giant gust of wind to the right just blew it. Disappointing.
Ben, you just described like the Jets as a franchise, an exception to about 3 years.
Yeah, well, and then the other negatives are two of them. Darrell Revis did not look good, and I think that's part of the we'll talk about him in a bit, but Todd Bowles has got to change the way he uses him, and the offense in the second half was just dreadful. Chang Gailey was way too conservative, and I get it. You have Ryan Fitzpatrick. You have a noodle arm QB, a guy you don't feel can throw 30 yards downfield, but you can't play that way in the NFL. Chan Gailey's got to open up the playbook. Matt Forte was pounding the rock. He had 100 yards rushing and 55 more receiving. I don't know why the Jets didn't try to go deep, and I understand it's Ryan Fitzpatrick, but it's not like he can't throw a 30-yard ball. It's not very accurate. I don't think they fed the ball enough to Marshall and Decker, and we'll talk about all this in a minute. And, yes, as Kyle said, we do have a very special caller on the line.
The noodle arm has gotten to, like, college dorm ramen noodle seafood flavor noodle arm. Just, like, the lowest level of noodle arm based off a week one performance. Can we agree on that?
No. Kyle, your jokes are so just garbage.
I'm sorry, man.
I normally I try to be nice and laugh, you know, fake. Just ha ha ha. No, Kyle, come on. Come on, man. You're not in regular season form. You're not preseason, sloppy defense,
yeah.
Vanilla offense form.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get back to the show. As Kyle said, we do have a very special caller on the line, former Jet Rob Carpenter and current New York Jets fans TV co-host Rob Carpenter. Rob, you are on the show. How are you doing today, man?
I'm doing pretty good, guys. How you doing?
We are good. Thanks for coming on, man. Let's just get right into it. Let's talk about this Jets game. First off, what takeaways do you take? what observations do you take away from this game? Against the Bengals.
Pretty much the same observations that everybody else has. Second didn't show too well. D-line played outstanding. It's probably going to be the best part of the team going forward. Matt Forte had a great game. Brandon Marshall was a little inconsistent. Fitz was very inconsistent. Those are things that I got to be corrected going forward and hopefully starting tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully the Jets can get back on track and play a full 60 minutes of football. Let's talk about Darrelle Revis, which has to be most Jets fans' biggest concern since, the Jets besides him don't have many other corners. What do you think about his play? Obviously, it wasn't very good. Do you think Todd Bowles should use him differently against Sammy Watkins tomorrow? Do you think he should stick with the man, versus man? Do you think they should use him as New England did? Just what are your overall thoughts on how Darrelle Revis should be used this season?
I think what a lot of people are missing is that Darrell was being used just like Belichick used. It was – can you guys still hear me?
Yeah, you're there.
Yeah,
oh, okay. What was going on was that it seemed as though the zone coverage was just a little too lax. On a big play to A.J. Green down the middle, so many people are pointing at Darrelle about it being his fault. It wasn't his fault. That was a basic cover three. Safety jumped the under route, and that exposes the middle of the field. Can't do that. A lot of teams will have that particular type of route combination in their offense looking for a safety who was going to jump the under route, and he did it. So that pretty much exposed Darrelle to looking like he was the guy who actually got beat. It wasn't his fault. The other plays, he was playing a little too lax on A.J. Green. A couple of the routes that were caught right underneath him, you're not used to seeing Darrelle be that far off of a receiver when the ball is in the air. Used to seeing him being playing bump and run, but as he's gotten older, he's come away from that a little. But going forward, I think you're pretty much going to see the same thing from him. And Bowles is probably going to use him the same way. The thing is, the D-line getting the pressure is what's going to help him out. So if we continue to see that, then I think you'll see Darrelle and the rest of the DBs get quite a few more turnovers and push up on receivers a little bit more.
Yeah, it was interesting that towards the end of last year and 4 days ago against the Bengals, they're not using Darrelle in press coverage situations that often, which is – he's arguably the best of all time in press coverage. You'll see him, relax off the ball, as you said, about 10 yards. And the Bengals with A.J. Green or whether it was Sammy Watkins last year, I mean, they're just running short little slants or curls or wide receiver screens, and Darrelle's, missing the tackle, and then that's a first down. I mean, it's just interesting how Todd Bowles is using him, considering he was a corner. He was our secondary coach here in 2000. I mean, he was a secondary coach for a long time, so you think he would have a greater knowledge of how to maybe use him, but, I'm going to trust him more than me because he's on the field, and maybe there's a reason why he's using Darrelle in that way. Well, let's talk about your career a little bit. You were drafted by the Bengals, so are you cheering for the Jets, or were you cheering for the Bengals on Sunday?
Well, even before I was actually drafted by the Bengals, I've always been a Jets fan. I've been a Jets fan since I was like 2 years old. So that's not even a question that I could actually even, you know, answer without comically laughing. There was no question about me going for the Jets. I really have no allegiance to the Bengals whatsoever.
Well, I mean, I've always wondered that former players, you know, let's just ask you, if you're growing up a Jets fan and you get drafted by a certain team, how is it conflicting to be like, I'm a Bengals fan now, or do you always kind of just secretly cheer for the Jets in your heart, in your case at least?
Well, while you're in the game, you're not even thinking about being a fan at that point. So yeah. The whole time I'm actually, you know, during my career, I wasn't a fan. So I would keep tabs on what was going on, you know, back at home. I know family members and friends, you know, to this day, who still, me growing up Jets fans, were growing up Jets fans, and, you know, but follow me along. Not that they would be fans of the team that I was playing for, but, you know, they just followed along with where I was and, you know, had some allegiance to me. But, you know, as it goes along, when you're in the game and you're playing during your career, you're not actually a fan of a particular team that you might have been a fan of as you're growing up. When you get out of the game, you go back to being a fan. So, you know, that's just a little difference. When you're in the game, mm-hmm. you know, it's a job. So you're not even thinking about that aspect of being a fan at that point.
Hi, Rob. Kyle here. And thank you once again for being on the show. We really appreciate it. Throughout Jets social media and, you know, Jets fandom in general, you've gone pretty popular. And now you have this you know, little thing going on with NYJFTV. What's it like doing that on a weekly basis? I believe you guys film every Thursday night. So just tell us a little bit about that. What's it like? I know you got a couple great guys, Fireman Ed, Kevin Sirkin, and I'm pretty sure Jay's standing there behind the scenes a lot of the time.
Yeah, Jay's behind the cameras. So, but, you know, Kevin and Ed, it just brings a little different dynamic to it. You know, Ed is a super fan, and he's always been that way. So he brings, you know, a great aspect to the show for being at the fan aspect. You know, that's Fireman Ed. Everybody knows who he is. And you know, if you've been a Jets fan, so you know the things that he's gone through as being a fan. And as we always talk about behind the scenes, it's just a little different with me because I bring the, you know, the player aspect to the show. And myself and Ed always talking about this, you know, he just likes to pick my brain a little bit about what actually has gone on or what might be going on during the week in the locker room. So, you know, I just kick it around with those guys like that, you know, behind the scenes a little bit. But you know, it's a fun show to do. You know, we have a good time when we're actually in the studio. So, you know, I'm enjoying it.
Well, Rob, I want to ask you because you mentioned, you know, Kevin and Ed, or kind of picking your brain about what it's like to be in a locker room. I don't know if you ever had this particular scenario in a locker room, but even if you didn't, just, you know, if you can just kind of infer what you think you would think. Well, two of the Jets' best players and legend players at this point almost, Darrell Revis and Brandon Marshall, did not play well. How as a teammate would you have handled that? I mean, obviously, I don't know if you probably wouldn't go up and say anything, but as a locker room, are you feeling kind of, you know, doubting Darrell and Brandon, or are you more, you know, they're going to rebound the next week? What type of relationship is it like that when you have a great player play, you know, piss poor, awful?
Well, pretty much, you know, it's probably just going to be a one-time thing. You know how hard those guys work. You know, it's the perils of the game every now and then. But those guys being vets, you know, as they are, they've been playing this game a long time. So you know that they're probably going to be harder on themselves than anybody else can. So it's not much that will be said to Darrell or Brandon by other teammates at all. Once you get in the film room, they'll pretty much know what they expect of themselves along with everybody else expecting of them. And they're true leaders of the team, so I'm pretty sure they took heed to what went on in the game and you know, remarked to the team that they'll probably play better this week before anybody even said anything to them. So, you know, we'll see tomorrow night. Well, I'm pretty much expecting both of them to play a lot better, knowing the type of guys that they actually are.
Mm-hmm. Well, Rob, last week we had Victor Greed on the show. And we asked him this question, a similar, you know, teammate, what would you do question. And I want to ask it to you. If the Jets ever had a situation like the Colin Kaepernick thing, how would you handle it as a teammate? Are you one of those guys that would be, you know, backing him in the locker room, or would you be, against it? Or I'm just kind of, Victor said, everybody has their, beliefs and things they fight for. And if he believes the same thing, he'd be out there, locking arms with Colin. Are you of the same wavelength, or do you think differently?
I don't think too different than Colin or Victor. I wouldn't go against anything that he's doing. It's free country. You can do what you like. Me personally, I probably wouldn't kneel. That's just me personally. Probably wouldn't. I'm not saying that I wouldn't, but I probably wouldn't. But I would never say anything negative about what he was doing, because he's bringing light to a situation that needs to be brought to the forefront. So I would fully, back everything that he's doing, and would hope he would probably continue it, and hopefully everybody would look forward to the conversations that are coming up about everything that he's going that he's actually talking about, because it actually needs to be said and needs to be talked about. But again, me personally, I'm not sure that I would actually kneel, but I would never be against anything that he was doing. I would fully support everything that he was doing. And if other guys decided to kneel or sit down or whatever, I'll fully support them as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, great stuff. And you and Victor are sharing the same sentiment. And I'm just always curious to hear, former players, reactions, to something like that, because you never know, this tomorrow, a Jets player can be kneeling, and you don't, and I've always just been curious to see it, how teammates would handle it. Let's talk about the quarterback position. Ryan Fitzpatrick, obviously in the first half he looked solid. A lot of his plays were, scripted and just, designed reads and stuff, and I thought he looked pretty good. I mean, that was the Fitzpatrick that you just kind of need. The guy is not going to lose the game for you. The second half was a lot different. They were very conservative. Why do you think Shane Gailey was so conservative with Ryan Fitzpatrick? Is it because he has a noodle arm? But I guess the counter argument to that is he's a 10 plus year veteran in this league. Don't you think Shane Gailey should have a little more trust in Ryan Fitzpatrick and definitely after last year, let him make his own reads and stuff like that? Or are you surprised at all about how Shane Gailey called this game?
I don't really think Chan was too conservative with the play calling. It was just Ryan actually taking the reads that he thought he would see and not really taking any chances down the field. In particular, one pass he threw to Brandon, maybe 12, 15 yards down the field, but he was quadruple covered. Go to the other side of the field, there were two guys wide open. So it wasn't really the play calling as far as Chan being so conservative. It's just that Ryan was actually looking, in my guesstimation, Brandon wasn't having a good game, and I think he was trying to force the ball to Brandon a little bit, especially on that one particular play. But, there were plays where guys were running open, and it was just, Ryan had a misread or decided to look to the other side of the field for whatever reason for the type of coverage that he saw. So going forward, I don't think anything is going to change. The shots were there that he could have taken. He just didn't take them. Maybe the wind, it was a windy day. Maybe the wind had something to do with it. I'm not sure. But, hopefully going forward, the reads that are there for the big plays that can be made, he takes a shot at those big plays.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's something we hope out of a quarterback we are paying $12 million for. Speaking of the contract that he has, do you think holding out over the, period that he did affected his performance in not only preseason but week one? I mean, we did see him struggle with possibly communication between receivers and just pure athleticism and arm strength. Do you think it had a direct correlation, or is this just a bad game for Ryan Fitzpatrick?
I think it's just Ryan Fitzpatrick, period. If you've watched his career, he's not been a big, a numbers guy. He's been a pretty average quarterback. And last year was, a phenomenal year for him. The offseason, can't really say it played too much of a part, because it was basically the same thing last offseason. He had a broken leg, so he wasn't participating in OTAs, and he didn't really start anything until training camp started. So can't really say that was an issue going into this year, because it's basically the same thing. And a guy his age, the rest will probably help him out. I think he might have mentioned that when first couple of days of training camp, where he said he didn't throw as much during the offseason, so he's a little fresh when training camp started. So, and he's been in Chan Gailey's system, so the communication shouldn't be a problem. The only communication problem there would be with maybe Jalen Marshall or any of the younger receivers. But the other guys there, nothing has changed. You know, it's the second year for everybody except for Matt Forte, and you know, that's not really an issue with him either in the offense. So that communication or him not participating in OTAs or the offseason shouldn't have a bearing on anything. There's plenty of guys who are going back to the same system, every year, and they have a little holdout, if you want to call it that, and don't start participating until training camp. It doesn't affect them. So, once you've been in the league for a while and you've been in the same system for a while, now, it's pretty much second nature to what you're doing. So for him, it's just being, it's Ryan Fitzpatrick being Ryan Fitzpatrick. If you followed his career, it's pretty much normal for what he's been, the type of quarterback he's been.
Yeah, you definitely have a point. And, you look at his stats, I believe he threw 2 touchdowns. If he plays like that, not saying he will, but he's on track for 32 touchdowns at this point. Now, obviously, it's unrealistic that he will continue to do this game after game. But let's move on to the next game, and that's tomorrow night. That's the reason we're here on Wednesday. Jets versus Bills. The Jets have not beaten the Buffalo Bills in 5 straight games. We have lost the quarterbacks like Tyrod Taylor, who, has been fairly good, E.J. Manuel, and then the lowest of the low, Kyle Orton. Do you think that the Jets can finally get this win with injuries to the Bills, such as Sammy Watkins, who will be active and playing, but he has a what they call at least significant foot injury that they are considering shutting him down for the year for, and then Cordy Glenn, their starting left tackle, being out. So do you think those injuries will make a difference?
No, I don't think so. Sammy Watkins, I don't think there's any chance they're going to shut him down. He's just had a little soreness in his foot. That's about it. Same thing that Edelman was going through with the Patriots. Once you've had that surgery on your foot, scar tissue might break, you might get a little pain, but I'm pretty sure Watkins is going to play, and he'll be a threat. But for what it's worth, I don't really know what the reason is why Jets having a hard time getting over that hump of beating the Bills. Might just be some dumb luck, but this year I don't think there should be a problem, especially tomorrow night with them coming out on top, as long as Fitz plays well or decent. If he throws 2 more touchdowns and only turns the ball over 1 time, that's a pretty good chance that the Jets have of winning the game. But in the other games in the past, there's been a lot of crazy things that have happened, turnovers, out the wazoo, which will always help you lose a game. So, hopefully you cut down on those things and the Jets will come out on top.
Yeah, that basically leads me into the next question I have for you. What is it going to take for the Jets to win this game? I mean, you basically just said Ryan Fitzpatrick, but besides that, we saw guys like Darrell Revis, Brandon Marshall, at some points Marcus Gilchrist, and a couple other guys really struggle in the first game. Or is their improvement going to take the next level for the team? Is that what it's going to take for the Jets to win?
Well, playing Buffalo is a totally different circumstance. LeSean McCoy is a different type of back than Jeremy Hill or Gio Bernard. Sammy Watkins is on the level of A.J. Green, but Tyrod Taylor is not on the level of Andy Dalton. So, it's a different aspect in this game. Taylor can take off and run. Something that Andy Dalton wouldn't do much. Not saying that he's a immobile quarterback, meaning Andy Dalton, because he can move. He can, get downfield if he needs to take off, but that's just not his style. Tyrod Taylor will take off at any point in time and make a big play. So, it's a little different aspect in this game that the defense has to be, sound in their assignments. Rush lanes have to be, sound. The defensive backs have to cover, might have to cover guys a lot longer because Tyrod Taylor can keep a play alive a lot longer than other quarterbacks, you know, scrambling around. So it's a little different aspect, but on the offensive side of the ball, you just have to take advantage of the situation that are there and not turn the ball over. So if that takes place, the Jets have a great chance of going up to Buffalo and winning this game.
All right, Rob, a few more questions for you. When you watch, being a former wide receiver, when you watch Brandon Marshall, what did you see from him? Because to me, I mean, a lot of people are saying maybe he's battling an injury. He had a hip thing during the preseason. You know, from what I saw, and the other thing is he lost quite a few, he lost a lot of weight over the offseason. From what I saw, though, when he got to the line, he didn't look like he was like he was trying to kill somebody. Like, you know, last year when he would get to the line and he was in his stance and they'd hike it, you know, he'd run straight at the wide receiver. I mean, he was intimidating. But it almost looked like he was relaxed when he was at the line. Did you see the same thing? Or what do you think is up with Brandon Marshall just from, you know, being a wide receiver and possibly having that insight?
I didn't see anything different with Brandon at all. From pre-snaps to things that were going on once the ball was snapped. What I did see that a lot of guys don't notice at times is that he was being double covered here and there. And that will take away a receiver, you know, 95% of the time. Down in the red zone, I saw him, you know, getting chipped and being released to another defensive back. A few times I called out a few plays while I was just watching the game and saying, yeah, Brandon's being doubled. I hope Fitz doesn't go that way. One of the times he did, it was one of the plays where Brandon slipped, and it actually almost turned into an interception, but actually ended up getting a roughing the passer call on that. But he was double-teamed on the play. He had to get away from the jam at the line of scrimmage, and then he was picked up by the safety as soon as he got off of that. So those are some things that are going on that a lot of fans won't see, and that goes back to what I was saying before about Fitz. You know, he has to see that and know that that's going to take place and go to the other side of the field where guys might be, you know, running wide open. One of the other plays that was down in the red zone, he did go to Brandon. He threw the ball. Brandon actually reacted a little too slow. It was in the back of the end zone. Ball went over his head. But he was actually fighting off the DB at the same time the ball was coming. So I don't really see too much different with Brandon. You know, the weight loss I don't think has any bearing at all. He didn't lose any strength. So Bowles is wanting him a little slimmer, which might make him a little faster. But, you know, Brandon looks like Brandon to me. He's still the same. Seen him a few times during our training camp. He's the same big, tough receiver that I saw, you know, in years past. You know, it's game one. There's a lot of overreaction that happens after game one. So, you know, it's common. You know, yeah, wait 3 or 4 games, and if things haven't changed, then you could actually make some assumptions about what might be going on. But, you know, he could have 10 catches for 150 yards tomorrow night and everybody will forget about game one.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, as you said, it hits one game. The Jets have 15 left, I mean, hopefully more. So yeah, Brandon has plenty of time to change this, especially since he had games like this last year. It wasn't as bad. But there are a few times where I remember him just being completely ineffective during a game. Rob, thanks for coming on the show. Before we let you go, what is your prediction for tomorrow night? Who's going to win? What's going to be the score, and why?
I think the Jets will win this game tomorrow night. You know, they kind of proved me wrong a little bit game one. I thought they would kind of win against the Bengals fairly easy. It could have been that way with a couple of different plays that would have bounced the other way, but I think the Jets do pull this game off. I think the D-line just continues to play like they played in game one, and hopefully the offense gets it turned around a little bit, and I think it'll be like a 2014 win for the Jets.
All right, thank you, Robin. But before we let you go, where can the fans and listeners reach you? We know you have quite a big Twitter following, so just give out your Twitter and stuff like that.
Twitter is at Rob Carpenter 81. You guys know you just started the show, NYJFTV. That's on YouTube at NYJFTV. Instagram, rcarp81. Those are the best ways to get me. Follow me there.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you, Rob.
Thanks for being on.
All right, guys. Yep. Have a good one.
You too. All right. That was Rob Carpenter, co-host of New York Jets Fans TV. And Kyle, let's just talk between the two of us for a little bit before we bring on the rest of our callers. So, Kyle, let's talk about this Bills game, because you know what? I don't want to talk too much about the Bengals game. Obviously, it's a hot topic, and again, we will touch on it later. But let's talk about this Bills game, because that's the real reason we're doing this show on a Wednesday. What are your predictions for this game? Not necessarily score, but what do you think is going to happen, what should happen? Just thoughts on this upcoming game.
In one word, improvement. I think the Jets are going to come out and improve on almost all levels. The offense specifically. Like Rob said, you know, me and him agreed. You know, I thought the Jets were going to win that Cincinnati game fairly easily, and if it wasn't for a few plays, they would have. You look at all the times they went to the red zone. Last year, we were the number one offense in the red zone. We had a terrible outing. We couldn't get touchdowns in the end zone, red zone. Sometimes we couldn't even make the field goal in the red zone week one, all right? So I think we got to put that aside right now and just see how we can improve. Got to incorporate Brandon Marshall. Got to incorporate Eric Decker. You know, Decker got his touchdown, but besides that, did you hear his name a lot then? I know I didn't, all right? Quincy Enunwa was probably our best receiver of that game. You know, we saw Jalen Marshall get us like 15 yards on a penalty. The receivers were not really active in the game. I mean, we were going against a very depleted secondary for the Cincinnati Bengals, whose best quarter is Adam Jones, a guy who's not even top 10 in my mind. Brandon Marshall's like, what, 6'5"? Something around that, Ben?
I think he's 6'5", 6'4", something like that.
Yeah, something like that. Adam Jones is 5'10", all right? Ben, that's only like 2 inches taller than me and you. All you have to do is throw a little fade up to Brandon Marshall in the end zone. That's actually an accurate pass, Ryan Fitzpatrick. All you have to do that was a couple times. You could do the same thing with Eric Decker. How tall is Eric Decker? 6'3", 6'4", something around there too? Right in the neighborhood? You do the same thing. Drake or Patrick is not a very tall corner. I think he's 6 foot at the most. All right, so the Jets had a huge advantage when we're talking about size here. I don't understand why we didn't do it. Chan Gailey continues to confuse me in these last couple games. Buffalo and then, you know, Sunday. It was not good play calling whatsoever. We got lucky that Matt Forte was able to get us into that red zone a couple times. Because without him, that offense would have been piss poor, Ben. We are lucky we had him. And they didn't even give the ball to Bilal Powell. What'd they give it to him, 6 or 7 times? And when he got it, when he finally got the ball, he broke off like 40 yards in those 6 runs. He was phenomenal out there. He was coming through. The offensive line and the running backs were like the only bright part of the offense. You know, Quincy Nunwa, he got a nice touchdown, but that was at the beginning of the game. He really didn't do anything after that. The running backs, the offensive line, defensive line, A-OK. Probably elite, all right? Everybody else, you're on notice. Ryan Fitzpatrick, Darrell Revis, Brandon Marshall, you want to get paid $12 million, $18 million, $17 million, whatever you guys are making? You better deserve it. Because we did not pay you this money to come out and drop balls, throw in the quadruple coverage, and get burnt. That's not what we're wasting our money on. Otherwise, I think you know the alternative. But I think it would be way too early to say something like that. Just a bad game for the Jets. And
please say it, Kyle. Please.
No,
please.
I'm not, because I know what you're going to do, Ben. You're going to try and patronize me, saying being ridiculous, and you know I'm really not.
Just to be clear, you are suggesting Geno, right?
No, God, no. God, Ben, that'd be the worst option. I was suggesting, like, making Revis retire, or, you know, straight.
Whoa, no, that's way worse. Okay, sorry.
If he's terrible,
we were on a completely different page. I really wanted you to just
throw
the Geno.
Terrible throughout the whole year, I would definitely consider it.
Okay,
because
well,
they keep saying move him to safety. Ben, is he going to start over Marcus Gilchrist and Calvin Pryor?
Kyle,
I don't think so.
Top three corner. The Jets just aren't using
him.
No,
he is not a top three.
Kyle, you are the worst. You know why? You know why, Kyle? You know why you're the worst? Because every freaking week you change your opinion. 3 weeks ago you were just talking about how Darrell Revis is the best corner in the league, and now he comes out and has one bad game, and now he's top 50.
No. I said he's the best of all time, all right? And I had him at, like, number 6.
I have the episode where you said.
Yeah, go ahead. So do I, then.
There's multiple times where you go, Darrell Revis is the best corner in the league. Oh, Darrell Revis is top three corner in the
best
league.
Best of all time.
Darrell Revis is...
You were always the one that said he was the number one, Ben. Because I remember we got into an argument on AFB's bro.
Yes. B.S.
Yeah, that was the chant we were making when Nick Folk was making that or missing that field goal and extra point.
Again, bad joke, Kyle. You got to get in post.
It's not a joke. That's a reality, Ben. That happened. That lost us the game. That's reality. Let that sink in. Reality thinking, Ben. You like that joke? You like that joke?
I like that one. I like that one. All right, well, Kyle, let's talk about it. The Bills corners, however. Stephon Gilmore, 6 feet. Nick Bradley Roby, 5'8". Leos yep. McCubbin, 5'10". Corey Graham, 6 feet. These are pretty short corners. And as you said, Brandon Marshall, 6'5", and Eric Decker, I believe, 6'3", something like that. All right. So if you put Brandon Marshall in the slot against Bradley Roby, 5'8", Brandon Marshall's to win every single time, no matter how good Bradley Roby is. Excuse me. So the Jets have to win this game. There, as Tyson Roush of Let's Talk Jets, there are no excuses. Now let's break this down. The biggest key to this game is containing Tyrod Taylor. In my mind,
yeah,
it's going to take exactly. every layer of the defense to win this game. And I know the offense has to put up points and stuff, but I'm way more worried about this defense. And I know that's the strength of our defense. One, our defensive line has to stop LeSean McCoy. That's their job. Their primary focus, and obviously they want to set the edge against, Tyrod Taylor. I'm going to change this up a little bit. Hold on. I'm changing this up. The defensive line's primary priority is containing Tyrod Taylor, getting after him. The linebacker's priority is going to be containing LeSean McCoy. And the secondary is going to be containing Sammy Watkins. Those are the three big playmakers, and all three layers of the defense have to be on. We can't Watkins scoring 80.
Add on Charles Clay. Add on him, too.
He is questionable. Well,
he probably won't play.
Yeah, they say Sammy Watkins and Charles Clay are questionable. They say Muhammad Wilkerson's questionable. And the reason they're touted as that is because they took away the probable tag, which makes no sense.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to get rid of that. Anyway, so that's the reason that Muhammad Wilkerson is listed as questionable, if anybody's wondering. That's the key for the defense. And I know that's like a lot, but if they can get after Tyrod Taylor, that should be number one, because that can eliminate Sammy Watkins as well. But we can't have LeSean McCoy breaking tackles. We can't be missing tackles. It's just the defense is going to have to bring their best game. Even though the Bills aren't the most talented team we'll play, they present an interesting matchup, because we're not great against speedy receiving backs like LeSean McCoy. Our secondary has proved they're not good against young, speedy, fast, amazing receivers like A.J. Green, like DeAndre Hopkins, like Sammy Watkins. The quarterbacks we struggle against the most are mobile quarterbacks, because they tend to get out of the pocket or run up the middle. It's just the Jets are going to need to bring their A game on defense. On offense, Matt Forte has to have another good game. The offense has to – I mean, I'm just listening. Everybody has to play well. But if I have to limit it to one key on defense, they have to get after Tyrod Taylor. On offense, they have to feed the ball to Brandon Marshall. He's the key to this game. His matchup's at 6'5". He's taller than all cornerbacks on the Bills by at least 5 inches, sometimes more in other cases. So let's keep moving on here to different topics. Excuse me. Let's talk about Matt Forte. I thought he looked fantastic a couple days ago against the Bengals. He really is a better fit in this offense than Chris Ivory. Now Matt Forte isn't a guy who's going to break it for 30, 40 yards. He's not a home run threat. That's more of our Bilal Powell. But Matt Forte, if you noticed, is good for 5 to 10 yards every play. He's a great receiver out of the backfield. He's probably better than Brandon Marshall on Sunday. And running the football, he did quite well. So Matt Forte and the offensive line are two huge bright spots. On the offensive line, Ben Ajulana should be the starter. Brandon Giacomini should not be on this team. The reason they're probably keeping Giacomini is because they don't really need to, to cut him for a salary, because they're in the middle of the season. But I bet you once he gets healthy, they're going to cut him. They're keeping on the pup list because they have to know, they have to see Ajulana and quality just a little more. Because imagine if they let Giacomini go. Now, look, Giacomini was not amazing by any stretch of the mean, but he was all right. He was bad. But he was just like a C-minus, D-plus type of right tackle. If Ajulana and Quali go out there and they're just Fs and they're awful, then they have Giacomini to look forward to. But from what I saw from Ajulana, and a little plays with Kuali, except he did allow quite a few pressures, so mostly Ajulana. From what I saw from Ajulana, it's not going to be necessary. I think Giacomini will be off this team within a few weeks. So, the offensive line and the running backs look good. The wide receivers have a lot of stuff to work on, and Ryan Fitzpatrick has a lot of stuff to work on, and so does the secondary. So, I mean, look, that game could have gone either way. The Bengals are a solid team. I know they were depleted, but at the same time, I'm not too worried. You knew there was going to be a learning curve with the young linebackers. You knew there was going to be a learning curve with Matt Forte dealing with the team, although that didn't really show. So let's just hold our opinions for a few more weeks. And on the Geno Smith topic, because I know everybody wants to, you know, just for me to say, you know, let's bench Ryan Fitzpatrick and throw Geno in there. Because let's be honest, Ryan Fitzpatrick is holding this team back. If he plays well, this team will win games. If he plays poorly like he did in the second half, this team won't win games. So the entire season relies on the shoulders of Ryan Fitzpatrick. The reason he's in there and not Geno Smith is because he's proven he's not going to lose games for the Jets. He's not going to win them, but he's just going to keep it at a nice 500, and it's going to be up for the rest of the team. He did pretty much just that. It was the secondary, and Brandon Marshall didn't show up, and therefore Ryan Fitzpatrick didn't play as well. So, look, if Ryan Fitzpatrick plays like this for the next 3 weeks, let's say, and the Jets are 0-3, he's thrown, you know, 6 interceptions, he's not looking good, I'm all for putting Geno Smith in there and just hoping that he plays like he did against the Falcons in 2013. Because if the Jets get that type of quarterback play, this team is going places. So that's all we got to say on that. We're going to start bringing on callers because we got quite a few, and we're already 40 minutes into the show. So our first caller of the night is Kyle from New York Jets Supporters Club. Let me get his theme song ready if I can find it. There we go. Kyle from New York Jets Supporters Club, you are on.
Panda. I got broads in Atlanta. Gigi don't be in the family. Credit cards in the scammers. Hitting the licks in the banner. Legacy, family. Wait and see, look like a...
Kyle, how you doing, man?
How you guys doing tonight?
We're good. We're pretty good. I mean, obviously we were very upset after that Bengals Jets games, and I've realized I don't enjoy watching Jets games. I'm not happy. I'm a fan of this team. Well, I mean, I'm being honest. I mean, when I'm watching the games, my heart is in my throat the entire play. Yeah, I mean, there's a lump in my throat, and I'm just, you know, nervous. I'm not happy. I'm biting
you
my fingernails. Now, look,
glass on the floor. I mean, the whole 9 minutes.
What? Okay. After the win, though, then that's when I enjoy it. If it's lost, though, then I'm not enjoying it. So the Jets very rarely make me feel good. It's in the offseason that make me feel good, or after wins, but during blowouts, during close games, during blowouts they're losing, or after a loss, I'm just depressed. It's like my dog just died or something. It's awful.
Jeez.
Oh, what, Kyle?
Why are you
going to play
to the Jets as something that low?
Kyle, you're off your game tonight, man. You're just kind of, like, awkward, and, like, your jokes don't make sense.
That wasn't a joke. You just said that a Jets loss. You're the one who said I was overreacting about the loss. You just, like, compared it to, like, your best friend dying.
I said a dog.
If you have a dog, they're usually, like, your best friend. They're called man's best friend, Ben.
Dogs are pretty dope, I'm not going to lie.
Kyle, is your dog your best friend?
No, you're my best friend.
Oh,
yeah,
the feeling
that was
is not
Ben,
mutual.
Not everybody's cat got eaten by a puma, all right?
Hey, we don't go there. We don't go to my cat getting eaten by a coyote.
Coyote, not Kyle.
Yeah, what are you talking about? Well, let's get into it with Kyle. What are your thoughts? This show is crazy already. A lot of background
noise. It's amazing.
Noise. Yeah, I know. Kyle, what are your thoughts on this Sunday's disappointing game?
I think a lot of it comes down to coaching, man. I don't get how they had 6 plays within the 10-yard line, and the only run that I remember, I could be wrong on this, but I believe that the only run they had during those 6 plays was Fitzpatrick on a scramble because
we had Forte up the middle, but it went nowhere.
All right. But, you know what I mean, like, even stuff like that. Like, I was thinking today, like, almost every pass went into the end zone. Like, you don't have to throw into the end zone. If you throw the ball to the 3-yard line every time, I promise you, and you get tackled right then, you're not getting on the 3. You're getting to the 1, you're in the end zone. Because laying down You know, someone like Brandon Marshall laying down is a solid 2 yards of just him falling to the ground. You know, like, it just didn't make much sense that they kept trying to throw it into the end zone, not trying to get 1 or 2 yards after the catch. You know, you weren't asking for him to bust something out. It was just very disappointing that the lack of communication. You know, especially in the secondary, there was a lot of problems with coverage. Clearly that big A.J. Green 80-yard touchdown, that was something I knew right away was a miscue because Revis turned around, looked all frustrated, like, that what you're doing, you know, cover your zone. But other than that, some players really shined, and I'm a very optimistic person. I'm not happy that we lost, but I saw a lot of positives. The offensive line was a genuine surprise. I did not expect them to come out and play this well. The defensive line was something else. I know how great this defensive line is, but I did not expect McClendon and Leonard Williams to be in the backfield all day.
I believe that defensive line right now, Leonard Williams and Steve McClendon are the two leading sack getters in the NFL. Ben, correct me if I'm wrong there.
Yeah, no, there are a couple teams that I'm trying to think. The top eight sack leaders, I think, six of them are players from the Jets and Bills. On Steve McClendon, sorry to cut you off there, Kyle, but, I mean, he had more sacks than Snacks did, I'm pretty sure, his, like, entire career. Steve McClendon looked awesome. The one, like, you know, stat, or I would count it as a sack, but it's not, that doesn't get counted is the end around where Steve McClendon stopped it for, like,
10 yards. That up.
I mean, he looked awesome, and I don't know the Bengals have a pretty solid offensive line with Clint Bowling and Andrew Whitworth, but maybe they weren't playing as, you know, well, but, you know, the Bills don't have Cordy Glenn, and we're getting Sheldon Richardson back, so, I mean, the Jets should be in Tyrod Taylor's face the entire day. They should have a QB spy on him all the time, though, because, you know, when he gets pressured, he's not the type of quarterback that's going to stay in the pocket and try to rifle it in there. Or try to take a sack, he is going to run for it. And if he gets past that first wave of the defense and he gets, you know, 15, 20 yards, then the Jets are – yeah, the Jets,
Ben,
yeah, the Jets are going to lose this game.
Ben, I got a prediction. You know I don't love predictions because when I do predictions, they always lose. But I feel like this is what Tyrod Taylor is going to sound like all night tomorrow.
No, God, please, no! 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 No!
See, Kyle, see how you do that, Kyle, is I take the time to go find that sound bite and put it in the computer, and I'm about to go play it when I have my finger on the mouse. Yeah, and then Kyle plays it in some dumb scenario.
That's what we do, Ben.
You didn't even set it up. That was awful, Kyle. Jesus. Okay.
I set it up perfectly.
Kyle, you're bad at everything. You're like a little...
You take that back, Ben.
No, you're like the kid who's like awful on the basketball team, and then the coach has to put him in the waiting seconds. Yeah, you're like the team's cheerleader and mascot, and you go in the final seconds. You're Kyle. Come on, man. That was my. Oh God. Okay.
He's just mad.
Anyways,
he's still mad about his cat.
What are you? Okay, Kyle. I'm gonna kick you off the show. You know what? Let's kick Kyle. We're gonna bring on. We're gonna just stick with Kyle from New York Jets Supporters Club as our main host. So I kicked Kyle.
Oh, awesome!
I can't wait for him to come back. Kyle, talk to me a little bit about this Jets secondary. They obviously did not look good against AJ Green, and they have arguably a tougher task next week, or I guess tomorrow, against Sammy Watkins. So what do you think about that? And be warned that when Kyle comes back, which will happen in the next 30 seconds to a minute, he's going to be heated. So make it brief. Or be prepared.
I think it's definitely something to be worried about. I mean, this unit's been together. The only loss is Antonio Cromartie. And, you know, even Marcus was playing a lot, and he played in the system last year. It's not someone like Deep Milliner that wasn't on the field. But, you know, with the short turnaround, that gives you such limited time in film to digest and have Revis be like, okay, how come you didn't do this? How come, and, you know, trying to figure out what everyone's thinking and get everyone on the same page, especially, you know, they only had like 2 days of practice already in Buffalo. You know, it's just so limited on what you're able to do with scheme, coach. And that's what scares me more, honestly, than Sammy Watkins and everything else. It's just the short turnaround that there's only so much you could really get to do. You know, it's just tough.
Sure,
I wouldn't be surprised if we see a lot of the same problems this week.
Kyle, you were saying, not New York Jets support. Fahy, you were saying.
You're a jerk, Ben. I was going to say something else.
What? What do they do?
You literally kicked me from the meeting.
Kyle, I didn't. I think you just disconnected. All right, well,
no,
we're going to...
Ben, you said you were going to kick me from the meeting.
I'm kidding, man.
Instead, Hose has kicked you from meeting.
Debatable. Well, let's talk about the special teams, Kyle. I thought they were actually, they had some great moments and they had some not so great moments. And
Nick Folk.
Well, but I don't want to pin that on Nick Folk because the blocked kick, the blocked kick is not his fault. That's the offensive line who allowed
what
that first rush to get through. The miss, it wasn't a shank though. That's the problem with that, Kyle.
Did
if
he miss
you watch
it,
the replay, it's not every kick. Kyle, this is what you don't understand. You've gotten so accustomed to using the word shank that's not what it is. Every missed kick is not a shank. It was right down the middle. If you watch it, the first 2 seconds of the kick, right down the middle, it's heading for the – and I've already turned around at this point. And it just this giant gust of wind just blew it to the right. It wasn't like something he could have adjusted for. Any kicker would have missed it if he kicked it at that same second that Nick Folk did. And he just pushed it all the way just directly 90 degrees to the right. I don't blame Nick Folk for that. I'm sorry. I know it was a missed kick. It's his first of his career. I think it was like 355 attempts. I don't blame that on him. I think it was unfortunate, and I guess you can pin that on him, but I don't blame him for missing those kicks. However, the special teams did look good in other areas. Their kick coverage was pretty good. Jalen Marshall had an awesome return where he broke like six tackles. Black Edwards is a star. Yeah, Black Edwards is a star.
You know who is the big star of special teams?
Watch him just use another one of my sound bites. Go ahead.
Lawrence Thomas.
Okay.
And man, he brought the bird.
Dude, we're not bringing on David yet. I can't. My ears cannot take any more of that.
Yeah.
Yes. Lawrence Thomas had a nice
hit.
He
lit that dude up. I mean, he just lit that dude up.
Yep.
I mean, that looks like some, who was the running back from Denver? Ronnie Hillman in the end zone back at UCLA when he tried to dive. I don't know if you guys have seen that highlight, but that boy just got lit up, all right? That was probably a really bad reference, but he got lit up.
Yeah, you could have used, like,
yeah,
Calvin Pryor hitting Rashad Matthews or anything.
That was a dirty hit.
Well, yeah, Calvin Pryor got nailed, and I was worried he had a concussion there for a little bit. Well, let's talk about them. Before we let you go, Kyle, let's talk about the safeties. Who Marcus Gilchrist had a mistake on the AJ Green touchdown. And Calvin Pryor did not really make his presence felt like we did last year. Are you concerned at all about the safeties, or are you just more like they're going to bounce back next week?
I think we're safe there.
I think, like I mentioned before, the limited film time and preparation time really, really hinders the team because there was a lot of mistakes. It just wasn't one play. It was consistently, just things not going right, that Todd Bowles didn't make any adjustments, that the secondary wasn't clicking. But I think that they will bounce back. I don't know if it'll be this week or next week against Kansas City. I hope it's this week because you can't afford to lose this game. But I think that, Pryor, the thing I saw with Pryor a lot was he was guessing the wrong holes. Like, I don't remember what quarter was in, but it was one play, it was a counter, and I was just watching Pryor that play because I was like, he hasn't done anything. Like, I wasn't paying attention to much else. And I see him run up, and he gets out, and he went to the outside, the wide hole. But I don't remember if it was Bernard or Hill, but one of them cut it inside, and they went to the tackle, and he got stuffed at the line, but if he got through the line, he had a touchdown. Or at least a 40-50-yard run, getting chased down by an opposite corner. But that was the main thing I saw. That, again, is something that, you would work on in film and preparation, but there's just not any time for it this week.
Yeah, definitely. All right, Kyle. I think we lost Ben for a second or something like that.
No, I'm just being quiet. I'm listening to you two. See, Kyle, when he loses me, when Fahey loses me, he has no idea what to do. He's a lot like Tyrod Taylor.
I was about to go on to the next host, Ben, or the next guest, Ben.
Yeah, okay. Well, hold on. Kyle, just be quiet. I'm going to mute him again. Kyle from New York Jets Supporters Club, thanks for coming on, man. Last question, what's your prediction for tomorrow night? Who's going to win? Why? What's the score? Et cetera.
No, the Jets are not losing this game. The Jets are winning. They're going to win by, I don't want to say too much, but I can see this being a 2-3 score game, maybe 2.5, you know.
That's scary, Kyle. Whenever I do that, the Jets always lose. Be warned.
How can you get 2.5? Are you just like doing a Vegas or another?
I say this every week, man. You'll get used to it. I'll say this. We could play the Pro Bowl team. The Jets will still win by 2 scores.
Anybody can beat those Pro Bowl teams. They're like walking out there.
Exactly. They could play 85 Bears. They'll put up 30 points.
I think
No, they're going to win. The defensive line is going to come out and ball out. Like you mentioned, Sheldon Richardson's coming back, and that's just another thing for them to scheme for. And that, even that takes away from Buffalo's preparation, because every offensive line coach and OC is going to have a lot of problems trying to go up against this defense. I think that they come out, they look really good. I think Darren Lee gets a lot of times just because of his speed, where you could use him as a spy a lot. Big Key's going to be containing, and I think Lorenzo Malden is going to have himself an amazing game. I'm saying he's going to have 3 sacks, but the Jets are going to win. They're going to look really good. They're going to look sloppy, but they're going to get it together in the second half, and they're going to come out.
They're going to look really good, but they're also going to be really sloppy, but they're going to win.
You know, don't worry. It'll all come together.
Kyle, I'm going to hope you know your Twitter this time. Give out your information, man.
I believe it's at @NY_Jets_SC. I think it's pretty bad. I know the pin for this show better than I do my own Twitter, but I'll figure it out.
Dude, I still don't know my social security number, and I
Okay. Kyle, thanks for calling in, man.
All right, thanks for having me on.
Thanks for being on. All right, before we go to the next caller, can I just say something really quick? He mentioned the 85 Bears, all right? I think any NFL team today would beat the 85 Bears.
Because they're old, get it,
No. Even in their primes. Today's athletes are so much better than they were back then. I'm not sure necessarily the Bears, but athletes back then, they were literally smoking cigars at halftime, never training in the off season, only training during training camp. Today's athletes are so much faster, stronger, better. Offenses and defense are so much more complex. If you put RG3, when healthy, and the Cleveland Browns on in the field, RG3 would run all over them, at least for a good portion of the game. Now, eventually they might stop him, but the Browns would probably win that game.
Eventually break every bone in his
and
body.
Like, yeah, unless
Dick Butkus hits him over the middle, man.
Yeah, obviously. Or
Mike
Singletary. Let's move on to the next caller.
No, whoa. Kyle, that's my job.
Hold up.
That's my job. I'm kidding. Last thing on that, though, is, I mean, the thing you have to remember about today's NFL, though, is the wide receivers all have these gloves, man, and that wasn't around in the 60s and 70s, man.
They used stick them.
For a brief bit, but it was banned, Kyle, and so we had about 20 to 30 years where nobody was using gloves, and now all these guys
career.
Have you ever touched – no, it wasn't Steve Largent.
Yeah, Steve Largent, the guy from the Seahawks, right? Wide receiver, white guy.
It was Biletnikoff. I can't remember his first name. Yeah, that was the guy who always used to stick him. Anyways. The gloves on today's wide receivers, man, are just – they literally all have to do is stick up a hand. I mean, you wonder how much of it is skill and how much of it isn't.
Those gloves from OBJ.
I'd love to see him try to catch a one-handed pass, you know, barehanded, like he does in games.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to bring on our next caller, as Kyle already said. This is Gangrene David. Kyle, if you can find that music, that'd be awesome.
Hold on.
Okay,
Chill.
Are you ready, man?
Yeah. 3, 2,
right,
1.
David, the show.
Here comes the Here comes the
y'all don't really want it like.
Ow. Okay.
Oh my god. I love
the music. Yeah, you just hear Ben in the background going, ow, ow, ow.
How's it going, guys? How you guys doing?
We're good. Did you go to the game on Sunday?
I don't want to talk about that. I've been upset about that for the last few days. But taking it away from that game, you know, I mean, there were some positives, some negatives. Positives, I love the defensive line and I love the run game. They were both phenomenal. The defensive line had 6 sacks, and now there are even debates on whether the new sack exchange of the Jets as for Forte and Powell. I have high expectations for them. However, the secondary looked like garbage. I mean, you had Revis getting burned. You had Williams getting burned. It was just unbelievable mediocrity from the secondary. You had Fitz, who completed just over half of his passes and who choked the interception at the end. I mean, the Jets should have had this game.
Now, David, is the sky falling for the New York Jets? Are they going to lose the rest of their games, and should they turn to Geno Smith?
I'm pretty sure it's classic.
Nope. No way.
I just want to see how far you are on the spectrum of going crazy.
Not going
to
happen.
No, he's got a Super Bowl bet to live up. If the Jets don't win the Super Bowl, he owes me $300.
Yeah, okay.
David, why would you make that bet?
What bet? I never made a bet. What you talking about?
He's saying that. No. Wait. What did you just say?
What you talking about? I never made no bet with you.
Okay.
He's looking for the soundbite.
I'm looking for the soundbite
right now. And
Tick tock.
Come on.
What you talking about? What you talking about? What you talking about? What you talking about? Huh?
Well, David. Yeah, David.
That took forever. It was delayed, kind of like Ryan Fitzpatrick's passes, but it eventually got there.
Again, just a bad joke, Kyle. All right, well, David, let's talk a little bit about Lorenzo Maldon. A lot of Jets fans were concerned about him gaining weight. They thought he didn't look too good in the preseason. He did have the Jets first sack, but besides that, he was pretty quiet. What did you take away from Lorenzo Maldon's performance?
Lorenzo Maldon played like a top-5 linebacker, in my honest opinion. I mean, he was one of the guys I had high expectations for throughout the entire offseason. I mean, he's bigger. He's great off the rush. He definitely proved that Sunday. So I'm looking.
What you talking about?
Does more.
What you talking about? Huh?
Did you just say Lorenzo Maldon's a top-5 linebacker?
I said he played like a top-5 linebacker. He played well, Kyle.
No, he had 1 sack and then he was quiet.
Okay, Kyle. Whatever you say.
I'm going to get this $300.
I'm just going to be quiet and let these two talk because they have such great chemistry, I guess. So
we do.
So just talk amongst yourselves.
When I'm not FaceTiming you, Ben, I'm FaceTiming David.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah, I do.
Please, just talk amongst yourselves. Let's let the viewers hear the type of arguments you guys have about the Jets. So Kyle, just ask any question you want. Because, you know, I'm tired. I'm getting bullied here on the show, man, and I'm tired of asking these questions. So, Kyle, you can ask.
No, Ben, I got your back.
Let's go to a private show, Ben.
Let's see what Kyle has for me.
Kyle, come on. Let's go see your questions for David, man.
All right, David. Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you for having me on your show earlier. That's on YouTube. You guys can go check that out at Gangrene David on YouTube and Gangrene David 1 on Twitter. We talked about basically the Jets versus Buffalo and Jets versus Cincy game. Now we're trying to look forward, put the past in the past where it belongs. So, David, what is it going to take for the Jets to win versus Buffalo and get their record to 1-1? You like that question, Ben? You like that question?
Come on. Hell no. To the no. Hell to the no.
Kyle and I made a pact to use the sound bites more often, and I'm really thinking of taking away from the show. So David, answer the question, man.
All right. So, first off, Kyle, you mentioned you got to maintain Sammy Watkins. He's basically playing on one foot, and if Darrell Revis doesn't maintain him, it's just going to be upsetting. Also, got to put pressure on Tyrod Taylor. You know, he's one of the fastest QBs in the league. And with this monstrous defensive line, with Corey Glenn out, the star lineman for the Bills, you got to be sure Tyrod Taylor goes down. And also, you got to finish strong because that's what the game is all about. You got to finish strong, and as soon as the clock hits zero, the final result is in. So, you know, if the Jets are starting out a little sloppy, you know, there's always a second half to come back. It's not how you start. It's how you finish. And hopefully the Jets can maintain that ability to finish strong.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're getting Ben back right now. I guess we lost him for a second. Well, let's just continue on. Yeah, we definitely highlighted containing Sammy Watkins and Tyrod Taylor. Do you think Revis has the ability to maintain Sammy Watkins by himself, or do you think he will need help over the top from guys like Marcus Gilchrist, Calvin Pryor, and Rontez Miles?
Can I continue for a second? Kyle,
yeah.
Don't kick me again, okay?
No.
Don't ever kick me again, man.
Oh, my God.
I will kick you faster than any – we can't run a successful podcast if we're kicking each other from the damn podcast, all right, Kyle?
You kicked me earlier.
I know. I regret it.
You were wrong
let's
for
just,
that, Ben.
Let's
you
just,
were wrong for that.
Let's just sit back and relax. Yeah. We're not going to kick anybody. We're gonna have a nice – this show is such a train wreck right now, man. I think this might be our top five worst episode of all time.
No, it's phenomenal, man.
It's just
funniest.
The more of a train wreck it is, the funnier it is, the more listeners we have. Like, there are people driving down the interstate tomorrow or the George Washington Bridge, wherever you guys are in New York or across the country, they're going to be laughing their butts off because we're talking about the Jets.
Or they're going to turn it off, unsubscribe, and give us a one star on iTunes. I mean, I don't know.
That's what I did.
To your own show. Okay, David, please answer the question before I just kick Kyle again.
Okay, so will Darrell Revis be able to maintain Sammy Watkins by himself? That's debatable. He will need some help. However, looking back at that Cincinnati game with that A.J. Green 54-yard touchdown, there was confusion on the route, so A.J. Green took advantage of that opportunity. So if Darrell Revis does manage to get help, hopefully there won't be any confusion between the safety and the corner because that was something horrible that happened on Sunday. By himself, there will be plays where he will maintain Sammy Watkins by himself on man-to-man coverage, and hopefully he can contain him, especially since Sammy Watkins is playing on that numb, injured foot. So the answer to your question, it's going to alter back and forth.
You just took the coward's way out of that.
What?
You took the coward. You didn't really fully answer the question. You basically just said that Revis will do his part and Sammy will do his part. You didn't really say
that.
We'll just go on to the same question. You know, you ducked that one kind of like Odell Beckham Jr. ducks Calvin Pryor now. But,
Boo.
Boo. Terrible joke by Kyle.
Yeah,
thank you.
I know. That's what I was saying.
Did you just try and play the booing sound effect on your laptop, David?
David's going insane.
This
wasn't the first time I played that for you.
It wasn't that funny.
No. I'm kind of concerned, Ben. But anyway, David, thank you for being on the show tonight, and thank you for having me on your show earlier. Go ahead and shout out all your Twitters and Instagrams and Facebook.
Twitters. Dude, you sound like my grandma when you say Twitters.
That's the point, Ben. All right.
So thanks for having me on probably the funniest episode of The Jet Take. My YouTube channel is Gangrene David. Follow me, subscribe, comment, like, rate. Follow me on Twitter at GangreneDavid1. You tweet to me, you message me, I message right back. I vlog about the Jets, and of course I had Mr. Fahey on earlier, and I enjoyed that. and I will be having my first gangrene David reaction this Thursday, so I am stoked for that, and thank you for pretty much entertaining me this entire night. I needed that.
No, David, last question for you. Do you still believe the Jets are going to go 12-4?
Yes.
All right, well, we'll see if they can't get half of their losses by week two, so they got to win this next game. All right, David, thanks for calling in, man.
No problem, Big Ben. Have a good night.
Hey, you too, man.
Ooh, Big Ben. Nicknames now. All right.
He always calls me. What the heck?
Okay.
He texts me at like 2 a.m. He's like, what's up, Big Ben? And then he does it like all the time.
And then he
that made it sound really creepy. I didn't mean it like that. Okay.
Oh, God. Can I just get rid of you?
Kyle, it's the other way around. I'm the one who runs this show, and you're just, like, here. You're just the one that's, like, the annoying one.
But we all know who the real champion of the show is, and that is obviously Steven. Oh. I'm sorry, I had to play that a little.
What was that joke? Okay, we're gonna keep Kyle, let's just talk between us for a little bit, like actually not just like having like a weird FaceTime call, but we're actually just streaming live. Now Kyle,
this will be nationwide like by tonight. Just letting you know.
Okay, Kyle.
So think about what you said.
Okay, let's talk about Quincy Enunwa. I think he was one of the bright spots for the Jets on Sunday. What did you see out of him that you liked? I mean, Brandon Marshall said, and I quote, he's 100 times better than he was last year. And it really showed. I mean, he was catching balls that he would definitely not have caught last year. So what do you think about Quincy Enunwa's play?
He got a touchdown. And, you know, that was pretty rare in Sunday's game, for the Jets at least. So definitely like that. You know, he's probably our best tight end, even though he's not a tight end. He's a good blocker, good pass catcher. He's definitely improved, and I think he'll continue to be a prominent role player in this Jets offense if Chan Gailey doesn't have to be such a sissy, I guess.
Eloquent, Kyle, eloquent.
Yeah.
I mean, if Quincy Enunwa can put up the type of production, even half of what he had on Sunday, the Jets are in a good spot. Because that was one of the questions for me. It was like, who is he going to be able to play that third wide receiver spot? You know, he actually looks pretty good out of the slot. It wasn't something I was expecting. He was normally that H-back, but he did play some H-back, but he played some out of the slot, or it was Decker and he was on the outside. But when he was in the slot, I mean, the matchups he had against the smaller corners, which you'll have again this week, I mean, he was just dominating. I think Quincy Enunwa can be arguably another Delanie Walker, somebody like that. So I'm really excited to see. I firmly believe in Quincy Enunwa. I'm not saying he is. I'm saying he can.
Are we talking about, like, talent or size? What are we talking
Delanie
about?
Delanie Walker or Jordan Reed, those faster tight end kind of H-backs. So, yeah.
Whoa. All right, Delanie Walker's 6 foot. He's shorter than I expected.
Now you're going to look up Jordan Reed. No, I'm just saying that I think
Quincy
he can be those slimmer, faster.
Wow, Quincy Enunwa was 6'2".
Yeah, those slimmer, faster tight ends. I'm not saying he's short. I'm saying I think he can be that type of he's going to add a new element to the Jets offense. They got their receiving backs and home run backs and Forte and Powell. They got their big number one in Marshall. They got their number two in Decker. They have an emerging slot receiver in Jalen Marshall, and they don't really have a tight end. but that guy can be a new one. He can be that. I'm getting to that. He can be that tight end. He can be that H-back. He can be that new sliver to the Jets offense, and I'm really excited to see that. Now, Kyle, I also want to ask you, was it just me or were the Jets just using, you know, pretty basic personnel on Sunday? For me, I felt like it was just every time he would – it was almost like they were still in the preseason with the type of formations and the type of plays they were running.
Yeah, I feel like Chan Gailey, you know, has become a little senile and just totally forgot.
Okay, bad joke, Kyle.
I feel like he just didn't know what he was doing out there with these play calls. He continued to do such a vanilla offense with the same people continuously, again and again and again. And it was just, you know, disparageable in a way. He wasn't using Brandon Marshall creatively. He wasn't using Eric Decker creatively. Matt Forte was basically, you know, one cut in the middle of the line. Bilal Powell barely saw any time on the field, and Ryan Fitzpatrick was throwing lame ducks. So this offense was absolutely the definition of vanilla. You know, usually, at least for the Jets, if we have a kind of a bad offensive game, it's vanilla with maybe some sprinkles on top, you know, maybe throw in some gummy bears, you know, all the fixins. But this time, it was just like pure vanilla, and not even in a waffle cone. It was in like one of those bowls. It was like a sample size. I don't know if you guys have that wherever you guys live, but, you know, here you go to the ice cream store, you get like a sample size. That's what the Jets offense was throughout the whole game versus Cincinnati. And that's probably the reason we lost. We didn't capitalize on any red zone, or rarely any red zone opportunities. I know Decker and Anunwa had their touchdowns, but the other ones were just, you know, field goal, field goal, field goal, miss, field goal. No, I don't know. I don't remember how many he had, but it was just terrible. Terrible offense, terrible coordinating. That's a terrible performance from the offense in general. We are lucky the defense bailed us out for the majority of the game. And then towards the end of the game, they couldn't bail us out because Revis was getting burnt like toast. We weren't getting enough pressure, so Andy Dalton had all the time in the pocket. Easy two-step drop, look down. You know, you got a cover two that was messed up. Revis is left flat-footed with A.J. Green, who can run like a 4-4, 4-5, running right past him for a 54-yard bomb. And now Revis Island has a question mark on it. So the Jets did not play well. Chan Gailey did not coordinate well. Todd Bowles did not do time management well. I mean, there's no other way to say it. The coaching was terrible. The offensive play was terrible. Hopefully we move on. We need to improve upon it. But, you know, that's basically all I have to really say. And I think we're going to go ahead and bring the next caller on the line, and this is going to be Alex.
Whoa. We need to give him his theme song. Hold on.
Yeah, I'm playing his theme song. Hold on. I'm pretty sure I know what it is.
Alex, after that very long and an eloquent theme song, how you doing, man?
Hey, great theme song. I like it. Al Black is awesome. How you guys doing tonight? Thanks for having me on.
We're good. I mean, you've been on hold for a while, so let's just jump on into it. You're going to be on the line for a while, so if that's all right.
It's been a fun night. You guys have had me cracking up all night.
My jokes are funny, right, Alex?
No, he's more
like... Don't quit your day job, kid.
I like Alex.
You're still my boy, though, Kyle.
Alex, would you be interested in taking Kyle's job? If I were to boot Kyle from the Jet Take, would you be interested in being the co-host?
I don't know if I can, replace the money, man. Come on now, Ben. I know it's been a rough night.
Yeah, I bring the money to the table, and I always cash that. We'll put it like that.
You bring flip-floppity, soggy, ice-cold takes, okay. Bro.
Colin Chan-Gailey,
senile.
That's his fantasy football name.
Dude, you called Chan Gailey senile, and I just let it go, but...
How are you going to get Chan on the show now?
Yeah, okay. How are we supposed to get him on?
I will apologize like I would to Lorenzo Malden if he ever came up. That's an inside joke.
Would you be interested in telling the Lorenzo Malden story for everybody, all the kids at home?
No, not right now because it's a long story and he misunderstood me, but, you know, I did not.
Kyle, I think that would be very insightful. Please go ahead, Kyle.
No, Ben, we really don't have time for it. I mean, Alex has been on wait for 76 minutes and 31 seconds, and you're trying to patronize the man by making me tell a campfire story.
No, it's not a campfire story. Okay, I'm just going to tell it. Kyle commented on Lorenzo Malden's photo, and Lorenzo Malden took it the wrong way. And Lorenzo Malden blocked him and on everything. And now Kyle...
Not Twitter. I still follow him on Twitter, though.
Okay,
so we're good.
Okay. Well, anyways, let's get into it. Alex, what are your thoughts on this Jets-Bengals game? Any takeaways from Sunday that people haven't already talked about?
Well, yeah, besides everything that you guys mentioned, what was surprising to me was probably the big play failures. I mean, way too many, you know, plays over 25, up to 50 yards. I mean, we got to nip that right in the base. So these guys got to go back to maybe some fundamentals and, you know, get back on the same page, because that was pretty brutal watching some of those big plays, especially from players that are really not that great, like Brandon LaFell, and I don't even know who that other tight end was, but he was looking like a superstar.
Yeah, I mean, the Bengals were that's when the secondary becomes my primary concern. I wasn't that worried about it because I was like, you know what, Terrell Revis is a top five corner. Buster Scream's a very good nickel. I like Justin Burris as the number two, or Marcus Williams, depending on if he's looking good. And at first, it looked like that was going to be the case, but as the game went on, the Bengals adjusted at halftime and learned how to beat us. Todd Bowles has to put help with Sammy Watkins. Now, I'm not saying Darrell Revis can't be one-on-one, you know, ever again. He can be, but when you're playing an A.J. Green or you're playing a Sammy Watkins, I think he should have some safety help. Now, next week when we go to Arrowhead, I would be fine for the first quarter, see how it goes, if he's one-on-one with Jeremy Maclin. See how that goes.
Yeah, because he's like a number two at best, honestly.
Well, I mean, Jeremy Maclin is a solid receiver. If he is getting burned, then you can try the put Darrell in number two, let him dominate.
Gets burned by Jeremy Maclin, we have a serious problem.
Okay.
Well,
we
I mean, you can't discredit
Maclin.
He's done very well throughout his career.
Yeah,
he's not A.J.
Receiver.
Green. He's not DeAndre Hopkins.
Yeah, I'm not saying he's...
And Alex Smith looks like a man possessed.
Well,
he's like a higher Jeremy Curley. That's how I view him, Jeremy Curley.
Okay. All right. On the secondary and on Darrell Revis, I think that they should try safety help with Darrell Revis on Sammy Watkins. What they should do is Darrell press Sammy. You're the best within the first 10 yards. I know it's five, but he typically goes a little over. And then Marcus Gilchrist helps over the top. I'm confident just rushing four on our defensive line that we're going to be fine, and we can make up. Maybe we put Rontez Miles in there and take out a linebacker. Therefore, Rontez Miles helps on the coverage, and you can still have Gilchrist back at quarterbacking the second. Like, there are ways to work around this. You can still rush four. Maybe you have to take out a linebacker and put an extra safety. There are ways for Bowles to work around this, and I think he's got to be more creative. Now, when he goes up against receivers like Jeremy Maclin, I'm fine with him press coverage. When he's going up against Doug Baldwin, I'm fine with it. It's just when he's playing DeAndre Hopkins or A.J. Green or Sammy Watkins, I think he needs some help. That's just my take on it. Now, Alex, let's talk about Matt Forte. He looked awesome. What are your takeaways from Matt Forte's game? I mean, I think he was the real bright spot, because I wasn't the biggest fan of the Matt Forte signing. I know he was a name, and I was kind of excited, but it's like, when you think about it, he's a 30-year-old running back. We signed him to a 3-year deal. He had his worst year of his career last year. It didn't look like a good move, but after the first game, he looked pretty good.
Absolutely agree. He's always been one of my favorite players. I'm a big fantasy football guy, so... he's on one of my fantasy teams as well, and he's just always one of those, you know, dynamic guys. He's shifty. He's a strider. You know, he knows how to just slip tackles with, like, you know, like guys are just, like, blowing by like air. You know, if you watch some of those plays up the middle, I mean, guys were just, like, missing by inches at a part. And his hands are great. That one screenplay, I could have sworn he was going to go to the house, but, you know, it's really exciting to have that player to, you know, rely on in, like, you know, third down, because I think we were 4-for-12 last game. So something definitely that we need to improve, and that's going to be somebody that, you know, we can feel good about getting a check down, you know, because it seems like we're going to be doing a lot of that. So definitely love Matt Forte this year, and he's going to be a great Jet.
Yeah, and as I said, I think the Bilal Powell, Matt Forte dynamic is good. And on that, I think Bilal Powell did not play enough. He's too good of a player to only play six snaps in a game. Do you agree with that? I mean, how should this
Absolutely.
Jets offense use Bilal Powell? Yeah, they were only using him on third downs, which I think is ridiculous. I think Bilal Powell is good enough. And let's be honest, this isn't a sustainable way to play Matt Forte. Obviously, he's playing well, but, you know, we got to mix in Bilal Powell there because otherwise Forte is going to have another Chris Ivory and won't be healthy by week six. So what do you think about the whole Bilal Powell conundrum?
I think they just need to, you know, start opening up the opportunities for him, get double his snaps at least. He's got to be seeing the ball at least 10 to 12 times a game at minimum, you know, catching and obviously carrying as well, because we want Matt Forte in the long haul too if we're going to make a playoff run. So Bilal's got to get his touches just to keep his legs fresh, Forte's legs. And, you know, not having a solidified three back at the moment, Powell's got to get more touches for sure.
Yeah, I share the same sentiment because we talk about Quincy Enunwa being a new sliver to this Jets offense. Bilal Powell adds he's the home run threat at running back. Let's talk about the offensive line. I think we've kind of just glossed over it this show, but the offensive line looked really good considering it was one of our biggest worries going into the year, which turned out our biggest worry should actually be secondary. Ryan Clady looked good. If he can stay healthy, I'm very confident in him that he's an upgrade over to Brickshaw Ferguson. Carpenter, Mangold looked good. Winters looked good. He had a penalty on him, but he again showed improvement. And Ben Ijelana looked much better than Giacomini did last year. I mean, the importance of this offensive line is monumental. Fitz isn't going to be good if he doesn't have time. He wasn't good. He did have a lot of time. And it opened up holes for guys like Matt Forte. So talk about, are you happy with the offensive line? Do you think they're going to put up the same type of production when they're going up against better talent like the Bills and Jerry Hughes? What are your thoughts on this offensive line?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because, you know, one of the things that I noticed is, you know, one sack, which looks really, really great. However, there was a lot of times where you saw Fitz throwing the ball on a two-step, three-step drop within an instant because there was pressure coming from all over the place. So was that, you know, a time cadence type of play with those checkdowns and those vanilla plays that everyone keeps talking about? Were those designed because the pressure was coming heavy and they're designed to get the ball out of there quick to avoid the sack and avoid pressure? And we did see a lot of them go in the dirt, which, you know, led to 16 incompletions. So, you know, I think, you know, you tip your cap to the offensive line for only giving up one sack. But at the end of the day, I think there's still improvement on, you know, the pass protection because I kind of feel that we're going to be in a lot of opportunities with our spread offense and we're going to have to throw the ball and get it to guys, you know, in tight corners and tight spots.
Yeah, and I would just like to say something, Ben, before you hop in. Technically, that sack, Ryan Fitzpatrick did take a sack, but that does not count against the offensive line because he was scrambling out of the pocket, and that was more of a – that's just how the rules work for the NFL, so that's good. It's a sack. We all saw it's a sack, and it will go against Ryan Fitzpatrick's stats, but not the offensive line sacks. It's like a weird stat, but I just wanted to point that out. Okay. What do you think the
Snapple fact of the day?
Yeah, Snapple fact, exactly.
The more you know.
That's from New York. Snapple is made in New York, so definitely like the reference there.
You know it.
What do you think of the best matchup of the game is besides Revis versus Watkins? What are you most looking forward to? It could be, you know, like a group of players, like the O-line, or just a single matchup, like besides Revis and Watkins.
It's a tough one because I was really thinking about Tyrod Taylor and containing him in the pocket, but you got to shut down McCoy. If I had to put out one offensive player, he's very dynamic. He's a good pass catcher. You know, he's got big play ability. So we definitely have to load up the box and make sure that we can keep him, you know, in check all day because he has that opportunity to just, you know, take over a game with his running and pass catching ability.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, people talk about, oh, we got to contain Tyrod, we got to contain Sammy Watkins. People forget LeSean McCoy is a top 10 running back in this league. running behind a very good offensive line, which granted has lost Cordy Glenn. Don't know how long he'll be out. I know he's out for the Jets game. That's all I really care about right now. So probably running to the outside, it's not going to be good for, you know, the Bills. I mean, I know their right tackle was not as strong to begin with, so now that they lose their left tackle, that's even better. So they're going to be forced to run in between the guards. And, you know, the way that Steve McClendon and, you know, obviously we've been alternating Muhammad Wilkerson, Leonard Williams, and Sheldon Richardson, now he's in the mix, have been rotating in and out of that defensive tackle spot, it's going to be hard for LeSean McCoy to run. So I definitely think we got to contain him, but I think we got this under wraps. I think that's not something we have to specifically, like, really, really worry about. LeSean McCoy will get his yards. He'll probably get, like, 50 yards. I mean, that's what you expect. It's a great matchup. I just think our defensive line's better than their offensive line, and there are only so times that Shady can break tackles or get away from a defender. Because you got to remember now, we got speedy linebackers like Bruce Carter and Deron Lee, who can actually cover LeSean McCoy coming on these little out routes, and when he actually breaks in two, you know, the mid-range of the field. So I'm glad we have that. And Ben, I actually wanted to bring this up. In, like, short yardage situations where it's obvious they are going to throw, but it's not going to be deep, would you possibly consider putting Deron Lee on Sammy Watkins? Deron Lee's got some exceptional speed. I'm just saying, for short situations.
Obviously, in short situations, you're going to Darrell Revis. I see what you're saying, and I don't think it applies to Sammy Watkins. Maybe if you're talking about a tight end, then you put Deron Lee on him and press him. That's the strategy I think you'll see the Jets employ on Rob Gronkowski. I think you'll see Darren Lee bump him at the line, stay with him, and then have Pryor or Gilchrist or whoever, or Revis.
This is why I say this. We saw Sheldon at points last year try and cover. It wasn't successful. But Deron Lee, obviously much faster, much better in coverage.
But not as fast as Sammy Watkins. I understand, but that is still Darrell Revis. Darrell Revis is still, in my mind, the best press corner in the league. That's why it's so mind-boggling that the Jets are using him 10 yards off the ball football. He's still not the same
corner
he was.
He lets them choose whatever he wants to do, according to Bolts.
Well, then I guess that's Revis's problem, but he better go back to pressing at the line. Can I touch in here on the LeSean McCoy thing, and then we'll come back to this. I think the Jets will have him bottled up for most of the night. However, I still think he's going to be a solid fantasy start because
Do you have fantasy, Ben?
No, I don't. I'm just saying this. I was about to
virtually slap you, dude.
You were saying how much you wanted LeSean McCoy the other day, but okay, anyways, be quiet. I think he'll get, you know, bottled up on most of his carries, but I feel like he'll have one or two big runs. That's my fear, is that occasionally or once in a blue moon, one or two times a game, whether it's 30 yards, 40 yards, 50 yards, a touchdown, whatever,
I'm pretty sure
he's going to be able to get around. He's going to be able to get around the perimeter of the Jets defense. And when that happens and he's going against Marcus Williams and Darrell Revis and stuff, that's when I think he can break it big. But for the most part, 90% of his to 95% of his carries are going to be just bottled up at the line. That's my prediction.
Well, here's my counter to that, Ben. And Alex, of course, you can chime in whenever you want here. How about we run a 4-3 when we see this happen? I know Todd Bowles likes to switch things up.
We ran 4-3 like 90% of the game last night.
Yeah,
I'm not,
I know.
Todd,
that's
doesn't impact
saying.
My
we
thing
run...
at all. I the Jets should definitely run a 4-3. I'm just saying.
All right.
And
how about this
definitely...
one?
All right.
You run a 4-2 with Henderson and Deron Lee as the middle linebackers, so if they have to, they can play coverage and throw Marcus Williams in as an extra cover safety or man cover corner.
So are you going – so that's six players, and then I'm going to assume screen Revis and who's your other corner, and then is Rontez Miles also on the field?
Well, no, I was going to go with the front four would be Sheldon, Leo, McClendon, and Wilkerson, and then you have your two linebackers as Deron Lee and Aaron Henderson. So that's your front six. And then you go with five coverage guys in the back.
So that would
so
be
basically,
Revis.
Yeah, Revis, Green in the slot.
Marcus Gilchrist, okay. Calvin Pryor, and then probably Marcus Williams.
And
there you
go. And you need Miles, Rontez Miles, because that's only 10, Kyle. So you
no,
you
no,
also
no,
put...
Ben. 6 plus 5.
Get your
5.
Abacus.
Ben, okay. 6 plus 5 equals 11, all right? We start 4 people.
Okay, okay let me think.
In the secondary. So we only add one more, Ben, all right?
Yeah, okay, sorry. My bad. I thought we weren't going to play the nickel corner. I thought we were just going...
Well, I'm saying for...
I thought
know,
we were going screen
maybe
and
from
Revis
third down situation.
And safeties, but I see what you're saying now.
What I'm saying, though, about the 4-3, I know we run it a lot of the time. I'm thinking specific packages here, specific players. And my 3 linebackers, because usually when you're running 4-3 with the Jets, it's because there's a run, there's a running back who's going on an out route who they need to specifically cover with up to 2 guys. They hope the defensive line gets enough pressure, or if that's a screen play, the quarterback's not going to get it off. That's exactly what you want to do with Tyrod Taylor. You get pressure in his face, he has to scramble out. If you can contain him, behind the line of scrimmage, he's ineffective. All right, he's not a great running, deep thrower, accurate pass, reading the system type of guy. He can make plays. He can throw from the pocket. He's good at that. Contain him. All right, you rush, our 4 guys in the line, that alternates. I don't really care about that. But at linebacker, I want to go ahead and put DeRon Lee at outside linebacker. You call it outside linebacker, but it would really kind of be like a Mike linebacker type of thing, or the spider monkey, as a lot of people reference it today. Just that guy who's either the quarterback spy or covering the running back. Throwing Bruce Carter and Aaron Henderson. Aaron Henderson is really good at middle linebacker. I don't care what people say. And then Bruce Carter is a fantastic coverage linebacker. You can basically take away there Tyrod Taylor, Charles Clay, and LeSean McCoy with those 3 linebackers alone, as long as they don't mess up. And then really all you have to worry about is Sammy Watkins. And you got those 4 guys, in the backfield, Revis, Screen, whoever else you want out there, to take care of Sammy Watkins. And I think that's what the Jets have to do specifically on defense. Because we finally have the speed on the defensive line to get to the quarterback, and then we are able to run with these running backs to where we can shut them down. And hopefully, with a group effort, if Revis can't do it by himself, shut down Sammy Watkins. Because honestly, I'm not too afraid of Robert Woods. I'm not too afraid of Marquise Goodwin. I believe that's their number 3 wide receiver. Don't quote me on that. But you can exit out all those guys at one time with that one package. And it would just work, as long as nobody really made a mistake. Which is the NFL. You shouldn't make a mistake.
Well, it sounds like we should just put Kyle on the sidelines, man.
Dude, I'm ready.
He's fired up.
Fire.
No, yeah, he's all ready. Well, Alex, before we let you go, man, a couple more things. Let's talk about the tight ends. No catches, no targets or anything. Do you think the tight ends should be involved more, or are you just sticking, hey, let's just keep throwing to Newton more? Because the thing I noticed is with Davis was on the field 90% of the time. So it's not like Nunwa is our tight end. He's just our slot receiver, and then Davis is just a blocker the entire time. I'm sure Davis went out for a few passes, but Fitz never threw it to him. But he was on the field like 90% of the time.
You
want to
know why?
Odd? No, obviously, don't, please. Okay. Obviously, he's not a great catcher. I'm just saying, are you curious to see why Kellen Davis is still on the field 90% of the plays, even on passing downs? Do you think he should be... Nunwa should just completely replace him? What are your thoughts on the whole tight end situation? Because it is our weakest point in the team. It's just like you can survive without a tight end. That's the reason we don't talk about it as much.
Oh wow, I am disgusted.
What, Kyle? What is
that's
that?
That's how I feel about the tight end situation.
Kyle, you're forcing them. You're forcing them like Ryan Fitzpatrick at the end of the game.
I already made that joke, Ben.
I know.
I made that joke.
I'm piggybacking on your bad jokes.
Yes. God.
Well, I mean, to be honest with you, I forgot that we even had a tight end. because, like you said, we don't throw the ball. It don't really exist in Chan Gailey's offense. I knew that Kellen Davis was going to stay, though, because even though he has terrible stone hands, he can block and he can sacrifice himself in front of a linebacker
or a defensive lineman for a few seconds and give enough time for a running back to get by. And I think that's just good enough for what they're trying to do with him. And he's an added lineman, you know, for passing situations to just give a little bit more protection when we're doing those quick read throws and, you know, we're supposed to be getting the ball to Marshall and Decker, even though we weren't doing a lot of that. But I think his main role is going to be protection all day long and just providing extra run support blocking.
Mm-hmm.
Can I just introduce a conspiracy theory real quick? For this
no.
is the best conspiracy theory ever, right? Forget
I guarantee
the Clinton,
it's not. I guarantee
forget
it's
the Clinton
like the
body double. Forget the Illuminati. Forget everything else.
Clinton
aliens.
Body double. What?
That's the current thing right now, Ben. People are crazy, dude.
You're from Florida, so I'm not surprised.
Yeah. You are literally from the hippie state, but
the hippie state. Have you ever been to Oregon, bro?
No.
Portland is awesome, man. That
from a stoner himself.
Portland's awesome, man. All right, continue.
Kellen Davis has pictures of a coach. I don't know who, I don't know of what, but he has pictures. Guaranteed. That's the only reason he's on this team, Ben. Guaranteed.
Kyle, I'm going to give you credit. Actually, no, I'm going to give myself credit because that was maybe the worst conspiracy theory I've ever heard. All right, back to actual football. Alex, do you think Ryan Fitzpatrick is going to bounce back tomorrow?
Nope.
Did you say nope?
Whoa. I do. I think he will end up with more total yards because I think he was under 200. It was 188 or something like that. So I think he's going to throw for over 200 yards. I think he's going to have at least two touchdowns. Interceptions, he better not throw any, you know, who knows? He might try to force one, and they might get a pick because their defense
three in the
is
fourth quarter.
Pretty much tough as ours. And, you know, as far as their offense is concerned, too, they're just as bad as us on third down. I think they were 3-for-13 last week against Baltimore. Mm-hmm. So you got two teams that are going to try to, you know, Buffalo's going to try to run the ball, and they're going to try to be tough. And, you know, they're going to play hard-nosed defense. So for Fitzpatrick, what you got to do is just control a good game. We got to take time possession again. You know, I don't know if we're going to be relying on our running game this year as much as we were with like Ivory last year. But you know, being efficient on third down, I think is going to be the key for Fitzpatrick and finding a new. Jalen Marshall's got to step up so that you know they can stop double covering Marshall or shading over Decker so that you know we get better passing opportunities.
Yeah, I mean, you hit it on the nail. Last year, the Jets were one of the best red zone offenses, and they were one of the best third down offenses. And Sunday, we saw none of that. The Jets were awful on third downs, and they were awful in the red zone. That's going to be a key for them to win. Last question, who's going to win and why?
So what I have here is 24-20 with the Jets winning it with a Folk redeeming himself from all that Twilight Zone kicks last week. And, you know, we're going to win the game on Nick Folk's foot, I hope, 24-20.
I Alex, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't think I could take that. I don't think I could take the Jets having to hit a game-winning field goal. That would just be too stressful for me, man. I'm hoping for a blowout, but I know it's not going
to
be like that.
If that's the case. Just letting you know.
Well, if they hit it, I'll be elated. But if they miss it, I'll want to slam my head against a piece of concrete. So
it's the Jets. They always have our heart in our throats. You know it.
Yeah. Oh, God. It's brutal. It's brutal being a Jets fan. Alex, give out your Twitter, man.
You can follow me at Rufio_187. Everything and everything Jets. Let's go, fellas. Redemption week.
All right. Well, let's hope your prediction comes through, the winning part. Thanks for coming out, man.
Thanks for having me. Have a good night, fellas.
Hey, you too, man. All right. Well, that'll do it for the caller portion. Kyle, what are the keys for tomorrow's game?
Well, like I said, Ben, we got to contain the guys who have been giving us problems in these last couple matchups. Charles Clay, LeSean McCoy, Sammy Watkins, Tyrod Taylor, the four best players on their offense. We need to shut them down. We definitely have the skills to do it. And I would just like to point out something wrong with Alex's thing right there. He said that Nick Folk would hit a game-winning, you know, field goal, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, but the final score was 24-20. All right.
He said 24-21.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
Oh, my mistake then. I thought he said 24-20. There goes that. Yeah, that's all I had.
Yeah, for me, I mean, look, last week I was right. I mean, I said the Jets need to get a fast start, and they did exactly that. And they, if they could have just held that.
Yeah. Down.
So we need a full 60 minutes of football. I mean, obviously, in the best case scenario, the Jets are putting up touchdowns every, you know, possession. I don't mean it like that, because that's kind of like a cop out to give as a key, because obviously, if they're scoring every possession, they're going to win the game. I mean it as they got to start fast, and in the second and third quarters, you don't want to lose the lead, even if you have to punt, even if you give up a touchdown, but don't lose the lead, don't give up a bunch of momentum, and in that fourth quarter we need good first and fourth quarters, and we need just solid second and third quarters. The other thing is we got to win the turnover battle. We can't tie, we can't lose it. The Jets need to force turnovers. Shady McCoy, he carries that football like I don't even know. It looks like he carries it with like three fingers. like he's holding a mug or something. I mean, that thing should be on the ground multiple times in this game. Tyrod Taylor, you got to force him into some bad throws. And most importantly, Ryan Fitzpatrick cannot be throwing this game away. You hinted at it. You were trying to be funny. Three interceptions in the fourth quarter. Yeah, no, he can't have that. Rex Ryan has beaten Ryan Fitzpatrick in the past by a lot, and he cannot do it again. Ryan Fitzpatrick has to rise to the occasion and beat the Buffalo Bills. Because let's be honest, Kyle, didn't you say you're like an aspiring rapper and that's you singing?
Yeah, absolutely, bro.
I honestly think my dead cat's like carcass sounds better than you. Anyway.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch.
Why are you playing Tyson's theme song? And dude, your dog literally couldn't be any louder. Oh, he's not going to respond to it. All right, anyways, yeah, as I was saying, they got to win the turnover battle. They got to play a full 60 minutes. And last but not least, Brandon Marshall has to get in this game plan. The Jets got to find ways to get in the football. And I think they should. They have the size advantage against the corners. This is the revenge game. This is the game I've been licking my chops for, and all Jets players should have been licking their chops for 9 freaking months. 9 months ever since January 3rd where the Bills beat the Jets and knocked them out of the playoffs. The Jets got to go in and get to 1-1, knock the Bills down to 0-2, more importantly. You can make the argument that's more important, and get, you know, tied with the New England Patriots and hope for a loss for the Patriots. And then you're in the lead in the division, and you got to, you know, or I guess you're tied. No, you would have the lead because of the division victory. So the Jets just got to,
the Patriots lose, first of all.
No, we got to hope we win. Let's take care of our own stuff. I'm sick of worrying about all these AFC other teams. Let's win our damn division. I know it's not going to be an easy task, and it probably won't happen. But if you stop worrying about the other teams and the Jets go out there and win, I guarantee you, whether or not the Patriots end up, you know, having a better record, the Jets are going to be in the playoffs, whether because the wild cards will happen. Dude,
yeah,
I'm just saying.
We just
the
lost
Jets,
to a team.
The Jets cannot, but Kyle, this Jets team is way too talented to not go to the playoffs. And if Ryan Fitzpatrick is holding his damn team back by week 3 or week 4, I'm pulling the plug on Ryan Fitzpatrick. I'm putting in Geno Smith.
Oh, God!
See, that's a good time.
No, God, please, no! 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 No!
Okay, as I was saying, if Geno Smith sucks, I'm putting Ryan Fitzpatrick back in. If he sucks, I'm putting Bryce Petty in. If Bryce Petty sucks, I'm putting Christian Hackenberg in. I'm doing everything because this team is too damn talented to lose because our quarterback can't hit a 20-yard out route. I'm sorry. I love Fitzpatrick, and I don't think it'll ever come to that. But if the Jets have to get their crap together, I don't care how
other Dolphins, they pass on first down, and it's picked off. Gerald Hodges inside the 10. Nightmare start for Geno Smith and the Jets.
Okay, and again, credit for the soundbite, because Ben. This team is way too damn talented to have their quarterback hold them back. So we got to figure out what we're going to do, and I think Ryan Fitzpatrick will keep the...
Bryce Petty.
Okay, is it just on a loop?
Yeah.
Anyways, it's just a loop. Kyle, look how much deep your voice is.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyways, The Jets got to get their crap together. And it's one game. The sky is not falling. The Jets did look good. They showed a lot of promise. If the Jets can put the type of effort they had in that first half for two halves, they'll beat the Bills. They'll beat a bunch of other teams. And I think this Jets team can go to the playoffs. It all comes down to one man, and that's Ryan Fitzpatrick. Well, he's got the... Look, throws, interception, Ryan Fitzpatrick. Okay. Anyways, I think that's where we're going to end it. The Jets got to win this game tomorrow, and I will say it is a must-win. However, the one thing I will say this, and just for the last couple minutes here, is the problem with Rex Ryan, and you notice Bulls' teams generally, I mean, I'm just going to use the last game of the year last year where we lost, didn't get up for that game. You're thinking, wow, I mean, it's the last game of the damn season. How are they not, you know, coming out there, you know, trying to lay us some heads off? The problem with Bulls is approach, but it's a positive in some ways, except in the last game of the season, which that shouldn't have been the case. So we'll use a different example.
Or the first game of the season.
Let's say this. We'll use this game. Let's say this. I guarantee you Bulls is, and he's already said this, that, you know, I know they beat us last year, but this is a new season. I don't care about that. This is just another game on the schedule. And that's kind of taking a page out of Belichick's playbook. But the problem with that.
Yeah, I want to get them fired up.
No. But
they beat
here's
you
the,
two
no, no, no,
times
no, no, Kyle,
last year.
Kyle,
they knocked
did,
you
did
out
I
of the
invite
playoffs.
You to speak, Mr. Fahey?
I don't care, Ben.
Okay, you're going on mute.
I
anyways,
really don't care.
I'm kidding. Fahey, let me just speak, and then you can follow up. The problem with that is, yes, the Jets haven't gotten motivated for a few games this year. But the good thing about it, and this really only applies when it's a game like this upcoming game, is let's be honest. If the Jets lose this game, it'll hurt. It'll put them in a deep hole early on. It'll crush their momentum, but they're not mathematically out of it. It's two losses. Realistically, we have them losing six
realistically,
games. Kyle, just please let me talk. Please let me talk. If the Jets lose this game, I'll be heartbroken and it's not looking good, but mathematically they're not out of the playoffs. That's all I'm saying. So the way Bulls' method isn't getting them all hyped up, and if they lose it, they're going to lose the next three games. The Jets thing is once you lose, you have to respond. It's not how hard... It's not if you lose, it's how you respond to those losses. So the Jets have to respond to the Bengals loss, and they have to beat these Bills. All I'm saying, Kyle, I'm not saying it's like if we lose, we'll still go to the playoffs. I'm saying it'll put us in a deep hole. But look at the Chiefs. They responded. They rebounded. The Jets can do the same. But you don't want to be in that situation. I don't want to be having that talk next Thursday about how the Jets can still win if they beat the Chiefs. And then they got... Yeah, no, I want to be talking about how the Jets are 1-1, going to Arrowhead. They're coming off a good division win. Let's go to 2-1. That's what I want to be talking about next week. That's where we're going to end it. Kyle, any last things? Because you were so eager to cut me off there. So any last things you wanted to touch on that?
I just have one more question for you, Ben, actually.
It's going to be another soundbite.
No. Name a quarterback better than Dak Prescott.
Name a quarterback better than Dak Prescott. Russell
answer
Wilson, Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers.
Okay, keep going. That's not the answer.
Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Okay.
Anyways, you can follow us at The Jet Take on Twitter, Instagram, and I promise most of our episodes are not this annoying. Well, that's kind of a lie. You can
that's
follow us on everything.
Lie.
We're on iTunes, SoundCloud. I gotta lock Kyle out of the sound bites.
You can't.
Yeah, watch me. Anyways, guys, thanks for tuning in. We're on iHeartRadio. We're on SoundCloud, iTunes,
woo!
As I said. Periscope, we will Periscope after tomorrow's game, so if you're listening and you want to see Kyle or I's reaction, if they lose, I don't know if I'm going to Periscope. I think
I will be sobbing.
Oh, okay. If they lose, I think I'll be too distraught, and I'll just go to sleep, but you know, maybe I'll do it the next day. If they win, then I'll definitely get my
like
positive.
That'll be like 8 o'clock for you.
Yeah. That's when I go to bed, Kyle. My bedtime's 6:30 p.m.
This is...
I'm kidding.
It's 7
right.
o'clock your time.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
Past your bedtime, mister.
All right. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching. As always, the one thing we forgot was who's going to win and why. Kyle, give your prediction, man. Don't do it.
I'm not playing anything.
Don't do it.
Ben, you saying that only makes me want to do it more.
Don't do it. You know what happens.
We go to Buffalo, all right? A team we haven't been able to beat in 3 years, five consecutive games.
Since 2013. Geno Smith's, like, third game.
Yeah.
That was the last time we beat Buffalo.
Yeah. They're a very talented team. You know, so are we. And honestly, I just think this is an easy pick for me. The easy win.
I love the confidence. Why are you saying it again? Stop playing.
I didn't play it.
I love your confidence, man, but every time I do that, we always lose. I was telling you not to. We can't be walking in with all that confidence, man. I'm telling you.
I have no confidence whatsoever in this team. Just letting you know. Okay. They've broken my heart too many times, dude.
Well, anyways, I'm not going to make a prediction. I think the Bills have some talent. The Jets are more talented.
Bull crap, Ben.
Dude, that's what I was trying to get. Okay, I think the Jets are more talented. They should win. They can win. I hope they do win. I don't want to say it because we always lose when I predict a win. So I'm not. I believe in my superstition. So we'll see how it plays out. But I'm hopefully the Jets will win, and I'm cheering for it. I think I gave out all our information. That was a train wreck of a show. Maybe our worst.
Ben, that was phenomenal.
But anyways, Kyle, the one thing I can say I think that's bad juju. That is definitely bad. I was about to play the can't wait sound bite. Kyle, don't you dare press it. But then I thought, well, then we lost the game. So I'm going to be superstitious. We're not going to play it. Thank you guys for tuning in. You guys are the best fans. We've really grown these last couple of months, and it's all due to you guys.
Ben, all right.
What?
No, next Thursday, I honestly can't
wait.
Kyle, and now we're going to lose. Just because of that, we lost.
Just because of that, we lost.
Kyle, I told you not to press the damn sound bite. And now what's going to happen is we're going to lose because you pressed your damn Bart Scott soundbite that I put in the... What am I doing, man? I told you not to press it.
No. Here we go.
No, God!
That's you right now.
No, God, please, no! 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 No!
Oh, Kyle, that's so funny. We've only played it like 8 times during this episode. We'll be holding open tryouts for Kyle's position. Just contact us. Stop pressing sound bites. You can contact us at the Jet Take. DM us your info, why you should replace Kyle with the hashtag replace Kyle. Actually, we'll do replace Fahey.
Can't touch this.
That's good you see that.
That's a good one right there.
We never get that sound bite any use. Anyways, guys, thanks for tuning in. You guys are the best fans in the league, and let's go get this W tomorrow night. Woo. We'll talk to you guys next Thursday. Hopefully, with a positive message. We'll leave you with the best chant in the NFL. Go Jets. Let's see a win. Let's see a win tomorrow, baby.
Let's go beat these losers.
Talk to you guys next week.